Of course, now I have here the place to introduce Wilfried. Now, Wilfried I know for quite a while, and I think I can consider him a good friend in the architecture scene. In many ways, I think our first introduction to each other's work was more through pavilions, installations, museum architecture, and the things related to that. Wilfried was for a long time a professor at the ZKM in Karlsruhe, where he actually invited us for at the time. And I think it is through this perhaps indirect kind of way into architecture or into a kind of shared set of things of architecture through the installation, the mise-en-scène, but also contemporary art, that we thought, of course, that he should certainly be part of the difficult double. He's one of the very few, I would say, contemporary European architects who is busy with the narrative of architecture. Has been made numerous exhibitions also next to his practice, which he has with his brother and Simona Malvezzi, Kuehn Malvezzi. And so when we then originally asked him to talk about Giuponti, Wilfried said, no, I want to talk about Carlo Molino. And funnily enough, we thought, come on, not again Carlo Molino, knowing he made an exhibition on that and worked a lot on it. But he explained me, and I think that's quite right, he said, having studied in a Giuponti building makes Giuponti into background for me, whereas my relationship with Carlo Molino is much, much more passionate, and for that reason, far more interesting, perhaps also more surprising. So, well, we look forward to that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kersten. I just have to push the button here, the arrow, right? It's going, it's moving, yeah. Yeah, thank you very much for your introduction and for your invitation. I will try to be as concise as I'm able to be, to make it not too long. And the question that you arise with Giuponti being background, I would like to take one step further. I think that the double, the difficult double, the way I understand it, looking at your invitation and your program, is not so much about an influence on you that created you, that was formative, but it's maybe more about how you, at a certain point, understood that maybe you relate to someone and to something, maybe also in a subconscious way, that is already there, but that maybe has not been the main influence on you. So for me, Carlo Molino has not been a major influence, has not been my the architect I studied or with, or his school or whatever. It's not something that I have like been taught, and so in that sense it's something that was more the other way around. I start with this quote, which is actually a quote by Hermann Cech, who is in my understanding a mannerist, a modern mannerist. And Hermann Cech was an architect that has always interested me quite a bit, because of his conceptual mannerism that he professed. And when I did the Molino exhibition as a curator in Munich some years ago, 2011, I, in my article, quoted Cech in order to open up the page and say why it's also called Maniera Moderna, that exhibition that we made on Molino. And Cech says, a mannerism is the conceptual approach to accepting reality on the necessary level in each case. It permits that openness and imagination which allow external processes to be set in motion and to be accepted without the insincere fiction that architecture gives up its claim to create an expression. Open, but nonetheless defined. Poor, but nevertheless comfortable. And I think that this question of realism that Cech invokes here is something that I have been actually rather interested in when I talk about Molino. And Cech here, to be seen with Kaspar König, I have to move a little bit like this because I don't have it on the screen here, so I want to see what you see. This is Kaspar König, the curator Kaspar König, with Maya Oehry, who was his assistant at the time, and Hermann Cech making the model for the exhibition from here out in 1984. So I want to start with this because this is a moment where a certain strange thing was happening. They were making an exhibition after some years after they had run another exhibition, where Oswald Matthias Ungers actually did the exhibition architecture, same curator, just 3 years before in Cologne. Westkunst was its name. And so you have this strange double already here between Oswald Matthias Ungers and Hermann Scheich working in a very few years together with Kaspar Koenig on two very different exhibitions. But we are now in the same historical moment, which is around 1980. And it's this moment when a certain kind of discourse on modernism and so-called postmodernism enters the debate. And this kind of mannerism that Czech now professes here after the Ungers exhibition was extremely the opposite and was also very much criticized for that, but was very impressive also. Something that comes now into the former, into the fore, to the real first plane of analysis is that we actually see that this kind of order doesn't function, although it's very formative, and this has influenced me much more in my architectural thinking, in my teaching, and this was taught to us in the 80s in Milan when I learned architecture. So this is the formative thinking I'm departing from in my architecture. But Hermann Scheich is somehow the spirit that has always criticized this thinking, and that is at the same time, here's the exhibition he made in 84 with Kaspar Koenig. You see, it's like a village of heterogeneous things. This was the playground they were playing with, they were working with, the forms they were trying to put into order and to create the exhibition architecture. And I would say here we have misfits and relations. We have all kinds of hybrids and bastards. We have all kinds of situations that don't quite come together. And this kind of situation where things don't really come together is actually where I would like to start from now. And I would like to go very quickly through a theme. The theme, misfits, hybrids, and what I would call curatorial design, which is a way how to deal with this, for me, starts very much talking about outdoor exhibition and museology with these two ground plans. We have the Prado in Madrid on the left side and the Uffizi in Florence on the right side, the two, for me, basic exhibition plans that we have. Both are museum architectures from the very first moment. And the interesting thing is that the Prado is all based on an enfilade, that is a thorough space where you walk from room to room, whereas the Uffizi, of course, all based on the corridor. It's all based on the gallery from which you go in and out of spaces. And these two very contradictory movements are basically forming every museum. Every museum you deal with are formed and shaped by this, by these two movements, by these two circulation patterns, and they never come together, apparently. And for us, it was the challenge, the first challenge when we did Document 11, to bring them together and to make actually a circulation pattern where we overlaid these two and made a system of corridors that were folded around an enfilade parcours. So we kind of like a hybrid of these two, where these two basically not fitting ways of circulation came together. And for me, this way of working, of putting things one into the other and having the misfits, so to speak, correlate, became very much a working method that I would say has also a lot to do with what I see in Hermann Scheich as a very interesting example of what he calls conceptual mannerism. So I founded then a magazine in which Kersten also contributed when he came to the ZKM. And this magazine, this player, is a magazine that deals with curatorial design in the way I understand it. It's this kind of thinking of how to make a discourse on space, in which space is a way, a medium, in which you basically relate things to each other that are not related before, that also have no relation maybe before, and that need somehow a curatorial relationship in order to find a relation. So rather than starting from the idea of a homogeneous world, it starts from the idea of a fragmented world in which then things come together. And for me, exhibition making and curating very much is this idea of bringing things together. So the Displayer as a magazine was for us a first way to do this. This is an image from an exhibition we did at the time some years ago of Jeff Koons in the Liebig House in Frankfurt. And again, it's the misfit of the Jeff Koons sculpture, of Jeff Koons with Cicciolina, that was installed in the Renaissance and Baroque sculpture collection. And it's somehow the misfit of the context, in which you don't read anymore clearly what is foreground, what is background, what is display, what is exhibit, what is figure, what is ground, where these two levels of perception actually start kind of becoming shaky. And this is a building in Berlin, the museum of the extension of the Hamburger Bahnhof, which we did 10 years ago, in which the bridge that connects the main building to the extension works a little bit like a photo camera that basically addresses the strange area around it. And the whole idea of two buildings that don't meet, that just don't meet. And this bridge itself is an expression of this non-relation. And this is a museum we are working on right now, in which we, again, have the problem of a facade that does not relate to its surrounding. And we asked an artist, Michael Riedel, to do the facade. So now we will have a facade covered partly by another facade. And the facade that he covers the building with is going to have a text on it that is actually a text following a parliamentary debate about the museum and its whole conflict of coming into being. There's a very political story behind it, and the facade now becomes a telling part of this conflict. Again, it's a part that doesn't fit, just like this image from this exhibition on German pop we did last year in New York, the artist space where we worked only with copies, where we copied Polke and Richter in real scale, so that we could actually put them into space very freely, and that they were very fresh, and they felt like 1963 again. And it was an amazing effect to exhibit pop art, really like pop art and not like museum art. So again, we challenged the museum. This was a cover we did some years ago for Aujourd'hui, in which we questioned the relation of the historical icons of architecture as a landscape, and this was a project we did recently in Berlin for a media campus, in which again, this was exactly the question now. Can you bring an icon, historical icon, like the Mies van der Rohe building, like the Chicago Tribune Tower, can you bring it as a negative space into a building, turning a building inside out, and making out of the historical relation and the fragmentation a positive discourse on architectural space? So I show these fragments, and I finish with this building here we are planning right now for a synagogue, a church, and a mosque in one building in Berlin, which is going to be built in the next years, hopefully, and where exactly this, bringing together elements that don't fit, very much make now the idea of the whole building. It's basically starting out from the idea that you have non-fitting, misfitting elements, religions that never have dwelt and lived together in one space, and who don't want to become one, but who want to share a building in which they all remain each their own. So there's a fourth space in the middle where they meet, and we made a building where you actually carve out everything out of one building mass. And to give this whole idea of working as an architectural curator, basically, or curating architecture, we made a book in Esperanto for the Biennale 2012. Also here, Kersten made a contribution, writing for the first time in Esperanto. And again, the question was, can there be something like a language between things that does not fit, a language between things that do not want to become one, because Esperanto is a language that mixes languages. And we made an installation also in the Biennale, making this our main theme now. Is there a possibility of basically creating an archipelago in which the islands somehow form a whole and still also become something a whole and still remaining themselves? This is the question behind it. So this was the building that Kersten and I had talked about when we talked about Gioponti. And it's a building that fascinated me always because it's also a double building. It's a building of two non-fitting parts that don't fit. It's also a strange building because Ponti built it together with Emilio Lancia, who then he split with after building this building. So there's also always this kind of talk maybe was the building actually already the split. One Ponti was more the palazzo, Lancia was more the torre. But I don't think so. I think it was also something, when you look at the whole building, it's very interesting that the two buildings, in the way they don't fit, again, then form something like a new entity. And Kersten and I were talking about this building, and particularly this building I like about Gio Ponti. And I had forgotten it totally, but when we talked last week, after we talked on the phone, our conversation started refiguring in my memory. So, but we want to talk about Molino, and so finally, now we have all the Molino. I wanted to start with Czech and our own approach in order to make sure that we look at Ponti, we look at Molino now, not from the point of view, so to speak, of an art historian kind of analysis, but of a pure personal interest. So I think after having shown a little bit what our interest in architecture is in the projects we do, it could become clear why Molino, for me, although we have stylistically absolutely no affinities, is someone I consider a very interesting person to occupy yourself with and to challenge yourself with, because he really challenges himself, I think, with each project in a way that is absolutely out of the normal architectural norm. Maybe you could also say he embraces the curatorial void that is created in the society of professionalisms, of skills. We are living in a society where everyone is ever more skilled in everything, but more partially skilled. So in between all these professionalisms we are living, something in the middle is opening, something like an open ground. And I would call this the open gap of the curatorial, because basically the curator figure started in the last 10 to 20 years to figure more as a prominent prominent personality in our cultural system, in the moment that this void was actually, and this gap was actually widening. And it's widening because we don't have a common language anymore. This is the Esperanto question. We don't have something that combines everything. So when Molino, who was kind of a dilettante in all kinds of skills and non-skills, from skiing to photography, from designing to drawing to dancing to flying acrobats, acrobatic flying, when he worked as an architect, his projects always kind of started from conceptual thoughts and not from the idea of a pre-given architectural vocabulary. And in this sense, I think Hermann Czech's quotation is true, also for Molino. He is a conceptual mannerist. When he did a project for a ski resort, and that was the beginning of the skiing industry in Cervinia, in Piedmont, in the 1930s and 40s, what Molino actually thought out was always the idea of a combination of the very historical idea of a hut on the mountain, together with a very modernist idea of a high rise in the basically city-like urbanization that Cervinia was becoming, because it was not a village anymore. So he actually confronted himself with this dialectics of the contradiction between industrialization of the landscape for skiing, and at the same time the idea that you have going into kind of like an intimate resort on the mountain. So he had the ski club in a wood hut, as a casa capriata, as he called it, on top of a high rise, and from the hut you would have like a little bridge that went directly into the mountain. So you would come by car, race basically with your car on the highway from Milan or from Turin to the hotel, then drive in on the bottom, go into your room, go up, and then as a skier you would kind of jump out into the snow. So basically he made this whole totally totally absurd idea of the skiing industry. He condensed it into one building using the vocabulary of the different issues involved. Not trying to make the high rise a hut, but also not trying to make the whole thing only a high rise. So I think here we talk about an interesting aspect. And this is a collage a drawing he did, and it's a collage in another way, because things come together here that don't belong together. Gio Ponti, in fact, had asked him to to make a drawing for his magazine in the early 40s. And he did this drawing for an idealist home. There was no possibility to build in those years, of course. And so he made a house, a drawing for a house for himself called Casa sull'Altura. So it's basically the idea of a modernist building. And then you see here in the vault of the ceiling, you see all of a sudden a Baroque ceiling. So this is very strange for early 40s, you know. The idea of having all of a sudden a fragment of a Baroque vault. And then you ask yourself, but what is this really? And it is a slight projection. So he had the idea of projecting historical ceilings onto a white cube, basically, that he had built. It was not a fixed drawing. So he had this whole idea of a virtual appearance of history in the modern house of the artist or the architect. I think this is interesting because it shows the idea of collage, of fragmentation, and of relation again. And from this period are also his very famous photocollages, which show this idea of collage very strongly. Ricardo Moncalvo did those with him and for him, and they expressed this idea of putting together realities. These are non-built structures he had just imagined, but he built a model, basically, photographed the model, then took the photograph of the model, put it into another photograph of plants he had done and of a background. So collaging together different levels of reality, he made something like a Photoshop. And Photoshop is very much the idea of bringing together things that don't belong together in the first place. And basically, when he did the Casa Garelli, he made a Photoshop, but he built it. He built it because he actually made this kind of stair in concrete that looks like something like a very thin and elegant stair to board an aircraft or something of the kind, or from a maybe swimming facility. And he brought it together with these historical rascars from the Piedmont, where he actually had one old rascar being taken down, bring it 5 kilometers into another valley, build it there on top of a socle of a new pediment he built with those kind of like pillars that are traditional there. And Bruno Reichlin did a lot of research on that. They were basically done to have the hay being dried upstairs, and so to have the rats and the mice not to come up. You had these in-between boleros, as they call them, and he built a new kind of like a stone pediment, which is actually now inhabited. He made out of the hay shack or rascar, he made a living apartment also upstairs. And so basically what he did, he made an architectural ready-made. He took a building that was already there and constructed for it a new kind of context in which he built it, and then he had this strange stair in front of it. These are all pictures, the colored pictures you see, are all pictures by Armin Linke, who is an architect by education in the beginning and then became a photographer, and is now an artist who I worked a lot with because he's really very sensitive to the idea of photographing architecture. And for the exhibition in Munich, we did a whole series on Molino. So he went to see all these buildings and actually photographed these very strange details that are not very country-like together with this rascar. And this is what came out of Cervinia. He couldn't build the one the way he wanted to build it with the wood hut on top of it. But something similar actually was done in the end. He built the skyscraper, kind of, in this industrialized ski resort. And then he had a little wooden hut on top of it. In the end, it was built like this. But interesting for me is, again, how the outside, which is very rational and also very clearly planned, then corresponds to an inside that is just as rational, with these beds that are double beds. You can actually stack them up, one on top of each other, make them double, in wood, and which has this strange, at the same time, this very strange relation to historical chalet architecture of the area, and in which he was quite ingenious with the detailing. But you wouldn't you wouldn't think there's a lot of irony in it, but I think actually this is not the point. I think this is really It's really about having the contradictions meet in one and the same building. And his buildings of the 1930s, his apartments above all, because he was an interior architect more or less in those years, always had these big photographic images inside. So what he did, and I think he's the first architect ever who has done this, he used photography in the very same way that artists later like Andy Warhol and so on would use it. Photography just in order to make cheap, big images of something that for instance, like waterfalls that he put on whole walls. He made he used engravings and sky, photos of skies that he puts on ceilings. But he really did the whole surface with it. And this very cheap way he also used in his private studio, where he had a butterfly wall, a whole wall of butterflies, but they were all just from books. They were all, when you look at them first, you thought they were real butterflies. I was also like a tombeau effect, but then when you look at them more closely, they were only photographs, you know. So it was like his whole interest was in the image. And this is a very important shift, because the shift we then witnessed in the 60s, and others like Venturi then start writing about it. But he already in the 30s basically made this shift in his architecture. And I'm quite interested in Molino looking at his architecture as something totally weird to me, where he would actually start from the image and then create out of the image his architecture. It's like this table that he did, using the image of the sculpture of Michelangelo, turning it 180 degrees and making it flat, basically from standing up, laying down, and made a table out of it. So this is a table in his Casa Milla. And Casa Milla, as you know, is the studio that he built without any purpose. It was a studio he built for himself, and he just used as an apartment where he basically hold photo sessions. And this is Vienna Pione that some of you might have visited, but that for me is very important, as it is the only existing structure today. It's called Casa Museo Molino, or Museo Casa Molino. It's basically kept as a living museum for Molino by two collectors. And it's a place where you can actually visit live. The last studio he owned, and in which he photographed. And in which, for instance, there's this chair, which is a very traditional chair from the Alps. And I'm interested in this fact that he actually would use a chair like this. Other moderns, of course, did this. We know that Adolf Loos was very interested in those very simple three-legged chairs from the 1900s, the Liberty chair and so on. We know the history of the basically of the stool and the chair that are simple and crafted and that would be just used. But then Molino also made his own variant of it, one for the architecture faculty in Turin, actually, which became the major chair there, like Giuponti's chair became the chair for the Milan faculty, the Superleggero. And so you see the difference between Superleggero on the one hand by Giuponti and this very sturdy Alpine chair that is basically a crafted, a version of a crafted chair with only three legs, but that is extremely robust. And he then, of course, made his photo sessions with these chairs. As you know, he took great pride in taking pictures of women that he dressed, undressed, and redressed in a strange way. And it's not quite clear what his main goal was in this, as they are not extremely beautiful, these pictures. So there's an apparent contradiction also in his relation to these women. And he had four apartments that he owned, in which he only photographed. He didn't live, but he photographed. So you ask yourself what the aim of this is. It's a little bit like playing with dolls. You get the idea that it's an unfulfilled desire to be a girl and play with dolls a little bit. And this is a portrait of him done by one of his models in one of these environments around the 60s, which for me is quite interesting because it's the whole question of who's the subject here and who's the object, which is not resolved. And this, again, may be now also seen as a metaphor of the relation between architecture and photography and the question how the image of architecture actually determines architecture today, and how he anticipated that in a very interesting way by working very closely with Joe Ponti on Domus and on Stile, when he basically for years was not so interested in actually making architecture as in publishing architecture. So he spent most of the time making these apartments, Casamilla above all, this one with this rail, this is very famous of course, with the lamp that is sliding. And of this he made publications one after the other, and very, very curated and very well thought out. But always something is somehow not fitting. There's this Venus figure as a mirror, then there's this table, and this is Casa de Valle. This is kind of like a kaleidoscopic mirror cabinet apartment he had built for a client of his, but basically used only himself, also again to take pictures. And then when he made this publication, he actually made this strange drawing in the publication down on the right, where he had all the points from which the pictures were taken, like marked, but in a very strange way. And it looks like a dance again. So you now have the feeling that he's basically also looking in a filmic way at his architecture. And in fact, when you visit a Molino building or structure, and there are not very many, the thing that comes that you understand is that actually you have to walk through them. They are not, they don't work as single shots, photographic. You have to walk through them. They are thought as movements. And he published then a book that was called Il Messaggio dalla Camera Oscura. So it's also interesting because it's the message from the dark room. So for him, photography happened mostly in the dark room, because what he did, he took the picture and then he went to change it in the dark room, so to speak. He cut off parts, he added, he collaged in and out. He did Photoshop basically already before it was called that way. So he made a whole book on that. He took big pride that his pictures were actually not only done by the camera, that they were not ready-made, but that actually the pictures were done afterwards. And he thought of himself as a big photographer in that sense, although he was not considered a photographer, of course, by anyone. But his whole way of doing architecture was then taking pictures and shopping away, let's say, all the context until it looked exactly like the architecture he wanted. And those he published. So if we did a history of the publishing of architecture and the imagery of architecture and looked at Joe Ponti and Carlo Molino in those years, in the 30s and 40s, we would actually find out, I think, that to a great extent these images that Carlo Molino made were the first ones that really like created a completely synthetic reality, that were not at all based on the reality of the buildings. And this is an interesting building because it doesn't exist anymore, the Società Ippica in Turin, his best, for sure, his best building. It's an amazing architecture. And we only know it, though, through all the basically collages he did. So we don't know exactly in detail to what degree this has actually been exactly like this, because what we have is basically the change, but the change negatives. But to a certain degree, we could trust this. And when you look now at the detailing of the shapes of this architecture, how on the one hand, this extremely square building is a rational, basically, Capannone structure. It's very simple. And on the other hand, he has this very refined and subtle way of doing the balconies, the entrances, and some of the features of the doors. Two realities collide and come together here, that don't fit at first-hand sight, but that make a lot of sense as a composition. And in this same sense, we know these pictures of him as a person flying the aircraft, although this was, of course, all fake. He was never flying over Manhattan, as these images try to make believe. He only did those collages again. He put himself into the background. But he was very, always, like, ready to publish those. And well, his interest was in flying, though, and he did really fly. He had several aircraft, and he flew, but he didn't fly to be fast, and he didn't fly to go anywhere. He was not interested in the air transport. What he was interested in was aerobatics. So he basically flew the aircraft like a ballet. He, on the weekends, went to fly the aircraft in order to dance in the air. So you might understand this very strange hobby. But if you look now at the drawings he made for it, again, they have something choreographic. And this is something I've been interested in when I looked at it, because, again, it shows you what we are so interested in when we talk about the visitor's movement, when we talk about the typology seen as body and space, as kinesthesia, and not only as building volumes. So when I showed those first two diagrams of the Prado and the Uffizi, for me, this is a very important basic rule. How do you move through space and how do you experience space? Do you experience it from space to space or as a certain flow, or do you experience it in a more utilitarian way? And I think that for him, actually doing these kind of activities like flying then somehow influenced his way of thinking about architecture. This is a design he did for a ceiling of a dance club in Turin, the Lutrario, Dance Club Lutrario. It's a late work of the 60s, and it looks like this. It's a quite weird building or space. It's still there, not fully kept, but you can visit it, and it's all about movement. You cannot understand the space in photography. You have to, but when you are there and you walk through this space, you understand how he thought it. So in that sense, there's a strong relation to Adolf Lausanne and the idea of space as a movement. This is a coat rack he did for his friend Italo Cremona, another artist of the period, and here the movement becomes somehow sculpture. And then he was very interested in skiing, and he was actually a ski teacher as well. And it's a strange thing that he then took a lot of photography also of skiing, because he was very interested how the skiing again worked as a body movement. And he had Leo Gaspar, who was a world champion at the time, and later training the Italian national ski equipe. Leo Gaspar in the 30s for him and 40s would carry a color photographic machine on the ski, as you can see here, in order to take as many shots as possible and to actually reconstruct the idea of the skiing movement. This is quite astounding as well. And then, of course, he claimed to be a car racer, although he didn't race himself. But he had this strange car built in which he took himself pictures of himself. And again, it's all Photoshop and scenography. But the interesting thing is the car was real. It also was driven by others at the race in Le Mans. It didn't win. It had an accident pretty early on and was dropped out. It was not a big success. But for him, that was not so much of interest. He actually had this car just made in order to take the pictures. And again, we have the question of the image. And then he took big pride in being able to bend wood in a way that no one else was. And I'm also interested in this kind of diversity of things he all of a sudden did. He basically bent this wood in a cold way. Others did it in a warm way. You know, Alvar Aalto had done experiments. The Eames had done experiments in the early 40s already. So when Charles and Ray Eames did their first chairs and their first bent wood things, they also did it for the war industry. They did it for those things that were needed for the war. Whereas Molino, in the same period, was working on doing it also under war conditions, having no possibility, no industrial possibilities in Turin. He worked on it in a way that he just got veneer. And veneer that he didn't have to bend, because he just used the thin veneer, made it wet, and put it over forms and glued it onto each other until it became thick. And then he had, of course, also bent wood. But it was a complete fake. But it works, and his furniture is world famous. So this is all a way of somehow making things work that don't work beforehand. And instead of trying to be high-tech, you actually can work your way through low-tech and somehow a way of collaging things together, realities together. So the only building that remains of his basically today is the Teatro Regio in Turin. Some of you might have seen it. It's a strange building, has almost no facade. You can hardly see it from the outside. It's inside of an old structure. It has certain lateral facades, side facades, but basically it's an interior. And it's a strange interior, too. It has this very glamorous, let's say, glamorous details, materials that come together that are very strange. It has these folded concrete ceilings always, then a lot of aluminum walls and glass. And it creates these effects of everything as if it were textile. The architecture somehow becomes extremely theatrical, really, in the sense, in the best sense of the word. So the theater is a theater, not only in the place where it's a theater, but it's also a theater above all in all the foyer spaces and where the visitors are. So the experience was, when you, for me at least, when I entered this space as a visitor, as a visitor as to the theater, that I felt like on stage the whole time, from entering the building to being inside. And I think that in these pictures of Armin Linke, you can kind of get an idea of this, that the spaces for the visitors actually have the same kind of impetus. Here you have the roof structure together with the Mole Antonelliana that in Turin. And again, the whole roof now also changed with some contemporary climate additions, as you see. This whole roof, though, has a very sculptural feeling and expresses this space also to the outside. And here in this idea, I would like to come briefly to an important theoretical base in his work. This photograph we found in his archive, in his personal archive. It's the famous apartment of Charles de Bestiguet that Dalí and Le Corbusier built around 1930 in Paris, and Molino kept an image of this. The idea of it was basically to go onto the roof and have on the roof this incredible view of Paris from the Champs-Élysées, also with this periscope, because the roof was actually hatched with walls and hedges, and you could only see part of the monuments, so they became very scenographic, because you didn't see much of them, but what you saw was then very cut out. And that was, of course, all around the news magazine Minotaur, the surrealist magazine done by André Breton and others in the time, 1933, 1934, in Paris. And Molino had all the numbers. He had all these numbers always come from Paris to Turin. Of course, Turin is also close to France. We have to know that this is the Italian part that is most related more related in many ways to France than to other European parts and countries. But it's interesting how the French surrealism in that moment actually shaped his thinking. And here you have the Sculpture involontaire. Of course, the whole Dalí context, on which Remcola is very much then referenced in the Delirious New York, using the same language. Now this is part of the beauté terrifiante et comestible. You know, this is all this language that Dalí used, and that is anti-architectural, we might say. But Molino was very much influenced by this, and he did this very strange installation in the 30s, in which he did an installation that looks exactly like, absolutely taken from the context of surrealism. It's called Tea Time, Tea Time Number 2, and it's a thing he did in Turin, in an exhibition. You see those strange hands on metal wires. You see a kind of like cloth that is used to make a body, to create a physicality. And then you see that this is a drawing of Molino's for the installation. You see those lamps, those household lamps, clamped to a certain kind of bar. You see that it's actually, it looks a little bit like a technical installation on the upper part. And again, when you see also the pictures of the ladies, how they're dressed, it's a very petit bourgeois environment there. You don't think this is the typical art gallery visitor. It's definitely not the visitor of a surrealist exhibition. So he did this thing in Turin, and again, a very strange transfer of ideas and images. He did a totally misfitting thing, basically somehow relating to a certain experience in France at that moment, bringing it to Turin, but totally changing its context, bringing it into this very bourgeois and non-artistic environment. So again, we have a misfit, and an interesting one. And his furniture, when you look at his furniture of those years, this is from the installation we did at the exhibition in Munich, where we had some of the furniture from collectors, and we put it on pedestals, and you see one piece mirrored by another piece. This is why it has this strange effect. But again, you have this lamp clamped up there in a similar way. This is a photograph of Man Ray that Molino owned and had in his room. This was the Surrealist exhibition in Paris by Duchamp, of course, with the coal sacks and the burning in the gallery space. And you see he relates to this kind of experience. His furniture pieces become like animals. They have this strange appearance of something organic, something weirdly zoologic. Very unusual way of doing furniture for an architect. It's not architect's furniture, we have to say. It's more artistic furniture. They're also mostly small series or one-offs. There is no attempt in making them really industrial. And these are coat racks, coat hangers. So this was in the installation in the Haus der Kunst. This is the cover of the exhibition with photographs by Armin Linke. And the exhibition was a way for us to work our way through the work by Molino. I will show you some more photos of Armin Linke now to finish. Armin Linke really went to all of these, and we traveled mostly together to see really all the architecture. And I would say that through the photography of Armin Linke, actually this architecture started reviving, because the Molino architecture, if you don't revive it through an active way of perception, like photography, it's strangely dead. It's somehow an architecture that you cannot count, that you cannot narrate. It's an architecture that you cannot, as architecture, can hardly structure. You can hardly show a drawing of. Basically, it's an architecture that you have to live, that you have to see, or that you can contextualize in his thoughts and in his other experiences. So you can ex negativo approach Carlo Molino. And that for me is a very interesting point, because it points towards this idea of the curatorial, of a way of looking at things from the outside, basically, or from the gap in between. So here you see these strange shapes of the Molino architecture in the mountains. This is not very typical for mountain architecture. I mean, it all doesn't fit. It just simply doesn't fit. And it looks a little bit like the top of the building is flying off. The building is half in concrete and half in wood structure. So he used two different constructive systems that don't relate, putting one on top of each other. The whole upper part is a pure wood structure, and the whole lower part is a pure concrete structure. And so he could actually realize on the lower part the cantilever, which he was always interested in, like in this building here that he did above the Lago Maggiore, one of the last buildings he built, and which is now in a strange condition because it's totally kept by the family, but the family wants now to get rid of it because it's a burden, and it's very difficult what to do with it now. And there was almost it would have been almost auctioned off with all the furniture, and that was held in the last moment last year by the state authorities in Italy because of the historical patrimony. So now the question is, will there be a foundation? Will there be someone maybe to take over this whole building with the furniture, which is the last existing overall example of his architecture? And I went there with Kurt Forster and Armin Linke together to visit the building. And we discussed inside the building, and it's actually interesting how the atmosphere of this whole structure is still there. And again, when you're inside, it's a perfect environment. It has the perfect comfort of a house. But when you look at the pictures of it, it looks everything totally awkward, totally strange and unresolved, like a collage. Basically, like if it was done in Photoshop and not really brought to an end. But this is what makes it so interesting. So you have this kind of effect. And some detailing is very beautiful. So if he wanted to, he could have done a beautiful detailing throughout, but it's only fragmented. It never resolved the whole. like in this Lutrario, I showed you already a picture before in this dance club. And the dance club has the interesting background that these tiles are so strange and so diverse, because out of economical problems and the question that you couldn't get so many tiles at once in one way, Molino then decided to buy only rests of tiles that were cheap because they were rests of other construction sites. So they just collaged together all tiles they could find in a given moment. And so basically there is no coherent design, not even in the tiles. As you see there, the ornaments meet in a totally awkward way. You have two completely different ornaments mingling, intermingling. And for me, this is very much a metaphor of his whole architecture, where this final attempt to make everything work and everything come together is not done. But a relation is being created. And I would like to argue that this relation that is created between the unfitting parts is actually curatorial and is what a good exhibition is about, is what a successful intervention today in this very contradictory world we live in is about, because you are not able anymore to bring everything together. But you have to create a logic out of the misfitting. And I would say, more and more, the older I am getting, the more Molino is interesting to me, because he's actually creating the misfit as a positive example, something that for me as a student was absolutely not attractive, because I was still thinking that you could resolve it all in one way. Thank you.
I think it's extremely interesting. Very happy to reconnect to Molino as a contemporary artist architect rather than, in a way, the romantic
exactly.
People, which we all take him for, no?
Yes, exactly.
In a certain way. Maybe I want to avoid to have a lot of questions out of respect for the next lecture, of course.
It's 7:10, we are good on time.
Oh, so bad. So maybe just one question / comment. I mean, you in your practice today in Germany, and of course increasingly all over the world to a certain extent, your interest in the curatorial aspect has always been very clear, I think, to us. But if you look at the production as itself, I mean, how wide do you dare to go? I noticed that in the projects you showed,
yeah,
and also increasingly, I would say, yeah, your work gets wider and wider and wider, whereas in the beginning, I would feel it was much more strict. Is that true? Is that also how you see it?
Concerning our work, well, what I would say is that I've never been interested in style, but strictness, yes, I've always been interested in a strict architecture, but style has been something I've never been interested in. I've always believed that lack of style is actually a positive point of departure. So in each project, we have always tried to do it differently, particularly, specifically, not to bring a pre-thought idea of form into a new context, but actually relate certain ideas and concepts to a context and then come and then understand the form of it. So, for instance, right now we're working on the Insectarium in Montreal, which is for me a strange context because I don't know Canada. I don't know Canada. I have to understand Canada. I don't know insects. I've never worked on animals, on insects. It's inside the botanical garden, and we decided that we would do most underground. So it's basically a place, it's not even architecture that you see then in the end, but you basically disappear, because insects live underground. So in that moment, I think you have a totally different condition from, for instance, doing the collections we did in Germany. We did several museums and extensions and collections. There you have totally different contexts. And so I would find it very awkward to do this with the same kind of vocabulary, the same kind of form. But strictness, I think, is in the thought. Like, the way we approach things, we always then try to find a very thematic and conceptual rule for the project. And then everything up from that moment on is measured by this one rule that we establish. So we have established for a certain project, this is what we're interested in, this is what has to be achieved, this is what the theme is, and then all the decisions following up will be always measured by the fact, do they resolve this exact question? And then sometimes it's uncomfortable. You have to then decide against your instinct in the moment because you feel like you would, maybe by taste or whatever, do it differently. But in the coherence of the thought, you have to follow up to a certain way. And I like this kind of strictness, to get beyond personal taste, to get beyond style, to get beyond things you like or you don't like. And in fact, this is why I think I increasingly like Molino, because for me, he's beyond those questions. He does very tasteless things.
But as a last point from my side,
yeah,
you somehow sneakily introduced surrealism as Molino's secret, I would say, legitimation.
Yeah.
Is your secret legitimation contemporary conceptual arts?
Maybe that's true in the end. Maybe you're right. Because I think what surrealism makes for Molino is the fact that montage in surrealism is the basic rule. You have contradictions that are not resolved, but that are lived to the max. And I think that conceptual art for us has been always a very important reference point in the fact that in contemporary art, differently from the architectural theory that you generally have, certain forms of contradiction and of a certain anarchy of thinking, and at the same time very rigorous anarchy, I would say, are not only allowed but necessary. And so you can actually conceptualize things in a more vehement, I would say, and more radical way when you go through conceptual art than when you go through architectural theory. In that sense, I think you're right. This is basically our conceptual tool. But I would see it more as a tool, not so much as a secret DNA, but it's well observed, yes.
Thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
So, maybe one last comment from our side. Next week, in the Difficult Double, there's two lectures. One of Productora, one X on Legoretta, and another one afterwards of Go Hasegawa on Tsukamoto. So it's quite an intense evening again. So thank you very much for being here, and thanks again.
I'll just take it on.
And please, as I said before, stay for the beautiful lecture to come. And thanks again, Martin, for giving us the time.
Thank you.